So today, the third sub portion of the chapter third on the proof, that is the privilege communication, section 122 to section 129, we will discuss. And after that, the two cases that is provided in your case material, one is on the communication between husband and wife, section 122, M.C. Varghese versus T.J. Poonam, that we will discuss. And the second case is on the section 123, State of UP versus Raj Narayan, that was the historic judgment, the historic case. And after this case, you know, the emergency was declared by the Indira Gandhi government. So it has very much importance about that. It was the election malpractices by Honorable Prime Minister at that time, Srimati Indira Gandhi. So that case, these two cases we will discuss, that is on the privileged communication. And after that, one remaining case, R.S. Madanappa versus Chandramma, also we will discuss, that is on the estoppel. I told you to ask to read this case. And if time left, then we even move to the witnesses chapter also. So first I'm taking the first provision, that is section 122. You also have to read along with me the cases, so that section, so that you can better understand. Section 122 is communication during marriage. So basically, section 122 protect the communication between husband and wife, the communication that made during the subsistence of the marriage. And this communication is protected during the marriage and even after the marriage. But the communication that is made has to be within the wedlock. So suppose there is a communication between husband A and wife B when they were not married, but just in the, as a boyfriend, girlfriend. So that would not be protected because section is very clear about that. Now, why this section is there? Why the communication is protected? And so the very purpose or the basic policy, because we have to discuss all these things in the brief, we cannot go in that detail because of two things. One is time is that left for your examination is less. And the second is if you see the value, the weightage of the question that has to be asked, that is also less. That's why. One major question will be asked from the dying declaration, one from the confession, etc. So in that perspective, there is a less weightage of this portion. That's why I'm taking less time. Otherwise, there are more things also to explain in this. So the basic or the public policy behind this communication is that, wedlock is treated as a sacred. So this is just the philosophical things, or you can say the holy thing. But the real reason is that husband and wife both cohabit together and they, exchange every actions, every communication between them. And so if this protection would not be there, there would be always a difficulty in every person that to whom he discloses each and everything. Because the wife and husband is the best companion in this world where you can share each and everything. Second thing is that to protect the marriage, because if the wife is or the husband is forced to disclose that communication, that may destroy their, the marital relationship. So because of this public policy of respecting the marriage, where the person can itself disclose everything to his spouse and to protect their marriage, the section 122 was drafted. In the English law, husband and wife is treated as one. So when you treat husband and wife, and suppose there is an allegation against the husband A, that A killed B, and whatever he said to B, his wife, B want to give the testimony. The court will not allow, because in the English law, both A and B in law treated as one person. That means B is also A. And how the accused, is allowed without his consent. So that problem is there. And that's why, Section 122 is there. English law is even extended this union beyond the Section 122 also. In many cases, the husband and wife is treated in the law as one. But that is not here. We have to, the scope of this communication between the wedlock is up to the Section 122. Now, read Section 122. The communication during marriage, no person, that means the bar is, the universal. There is no exception in that a king or a person from the lower rank can disclose, etc. No person who is or has been married, who is married or who has been married. That means this phrase cover the communication that is made during the marriage, whether that marriage now is in the subsistence. If it is in the subsistence, that means who is. And that marriage already dissolved, but the communication was made during the marriage. That means who has been married. Shall be compelled to disclose any communication made to him during the marriage by any person to whom he is or has been married. That means it protects the communication from husband to wife or wife to the husband. So when a communication is made between by husband to wife or wife to husband during the marriage, in that case, the person to whom the communication was made cannot be compelled to disclose that communication before the court, whether that marriage was in subsistence or the marriage is already dissolved. Okay, that means cannot be compelled. The second question is that suppose the person herself or himself want to disclose. Okay, take the example like A is the husband and B is the wife. A allegedly murdered C, and then he discloses all these murder history to his wife B. In normal course, wife was want to save her husband, but then there was a dispute between husband and wife. Ab wo keh rahi nahi main to aapko saza dila ke rahungi, and now she want to disclose this communication before the court of law. The first thing that when suppose the defense side, C side, who was killed, if they want to force the wife, no, they cannot. The first portion of the Section 122 protect that. Whether the wife voluntarily want to give the testimony of whatever the communication made by her husband to herself, for that there is a second part of this section, that nor shall be permitted to disclose. So nor shall be permitted to disclose, that even when in this particular case, the example I have put, the wife want to give the testimony, she shall not be permitted to disclose such communication. She shall not be permitted to disclose. So neither the husband or wife compelled to disclose, nor they permitted to disclose. Okay, so voluntarily they cannot disclose, and involuntarily they cannot be compelled to disclose the communication during their marriage. Okay, unless the person who made it means who communicated it, who made the communication, or his representative in interest consent. So in case they cannot be compelled, but in case voluntarily husband or wife want to make the communication, want to give the evidence of the communication, want to disclose the communication, in that case, if husband or wife, they consent, against whom there is a case, if they consent, then that is allowed. Like in our case, A was, there was allegation against A that A killed C, and now after the dispute, B want to give the testimony, want to disclose. If A consent, okay, B can give, then C is permitted. Otherwise, C would not be permitted, but if A allows, if A consent, then can be permitted. Okay. But what about the situation when there is the allegation on A that A has defamed B or A has slapped B? So the situation where the dispute is between A and B may be of the civil nature or of the criminal nature. So in that case, if the latter part of the section 120 would not be there, that would create the difficulty that how they will protect. Because if there is any situation related to the communication, they are not allowed and they are not even permitted without the consent. And so the latter part says that except in the suit between the married person or the proceeding in which one married person is prosecuted for crime committed against the others. So, except in the situation, the both the upper part will be applicable. So, one cannot be compelled to disclose any communication or cannot be permitted to disclose any communication unless consent. But these rules will not be applicable when there is a suit between husband and wife or when there is a criminal proceeding between husband. So, if there is a criminal proceeding that A caused grievous hurt to B, his wife, the communication, what he said during this thing, that is not protected by section 122. If there is a suit, civil proceeding, whatever A said to the B, because of it was during the marriage, section 122 upper part protect, but lower part say that it would not be held as a privileged communication, that can be proved. So this is section 122, communication during the marriage. Yes. Do any of you have any doubt on the section 122 on the interpretation? Yes, please. You can ask me. Mr. Ajay. Yes, Mr. Ajay. Ronak. Ramkaran. Yes, please respond. Abhimanyu.
No, sir.
Any doubt, any confusion, any question you have on the interpretation of section 122, or should I proceed further?
So you can proceed. I don't have any doubt.
Sir, can a mother depose against... Okay, Ramkaran said no question, but there is one question from Arsad. Sir, can a mother depose against her husband in case he is guilty of raping his daughter? See, as such a witness, the mother can be witness, section 120 is there. When you read section 120, very good question, Arsad Ayub, you made it. Because as such, if I say that section is clear, aapko ye nahi pouchna chahiye tha, it is about only the communication. So that would be injustice because you are at very, early stage. So a very good question because it clarifies that what is the difference between section 120 and section 123. And very good observation, Arsad. Section 120 talk about, like section 117, 18, 118, 19, 118, 119, etc. That have the rule related to who can be witness. And then their question comes whether husband and wife can be witness against themselves. So they can be witness. Okay, section 120, I'm reading and then you have to observe it. Parties to the civil suit and their wives or husband or wife of a person under criminal trial. In all civil proceedings, the parties to the suit and the husband or wife of any party to the suit shall be competent witness in criminal proceeding against any person. The husband or wife of such person respectively shall be competent witness. So I think you have got your answer. That the mother can be the competent witness in case there is a raping of the girl by the father. Okay, but section 123 does not say that the wife, because in this case that Asad put before us, that the offense committed against the daughter, and the question is that whether mother can depose. So that means the problem is that whether mother can be a competent witness, and section 120 answer it that yes, she can be a competent witness. But the question whether the communication that is made between mother and mother and the husband, so that communication is protected under section 123. So suppose in this case there is a communication with respect to the the raping of the girl. So that much of the, communication is protected. But yes, of course, for other thing, what the mother have, listened, what the mother have saw raping the girl, or mother have observed other things, or the mother have, get the other documents, all these things can be proved. But only the communication that is made, that much of the communication is protected by section 122. Okay, is it clear, Arsad? Yeah. Now come to the next section, and the important case that we have on section 122 is MC Varghese versus TJ Poonen. So in this case, husband wrote letter to his wife and about saying bad thing about the father of wife. कि आपके पिताजी गंदे हैं, बेकार हैं, व्हाटएवर जो भी. एंड देन द द फादर इन लॉ, दैट मीन द फादर ऑफ द वाइफ, ही फाइल्ड अ डिफेमेशन सूट अगेंस्ट हिज सन इन लॉ. एंड द मूटेड क्वेश्चन इन द कोर्ट बिकेम वेदर दिस कम्युनिकेशन बिटवीन हस्बैंड एंड वाइफ, कैन दिस कम्युनिकेशन बी परमिटेड. And so the whole question is whether this is the communication protected under section 122 or not. So come to the next section. Yes, you see, when the students ask the questions, really the teaching will be much effective. And that's why I always say, I give the time that you must ask so that I find the opportunity to explain further. Section 123, evidence as to the affairs of the state. See, in the jurisprudence also you have heard about that there are three interests, and the one sociological point or sociological school of jurisprudence is that law is nothing but the balancing of interest. And what are those interests? There are three interests. Individual interest, like me and we have right to vote, it is individual interest. Me and we have right to speak, it is individual interest. Societal interest. And the third one is the state interest. So state interest is different from societal interest. So societal interest, like that there should not be the crime. So the whole criminal law, like the Ducati or etc., where the state is the one of the party, is somehow related to societal interest. But section 124A, sedition etc., that is protecting state interest. Okay, so state interest. Now state is one of the interest, and in the state there is a state machinery, there is the communication that we can say that official communication or the affairs of the state, how they has to run. And these communication, they're also the privileged communication. Something is not permitted. Because if that is permitted, that would cause, there is again the public policy that would be against the societal interest, against the state interest. The harm would be caused. If someone say that, what were the consideration for doing this particular act or the produce the document relating to this thing. So there is a public policy behind Section 123. And to protect the state interest, to protect the larger public interest, Section 123 is drafted. No one, Section 123, evidence as to the affairs of state, no one shall be permitted to give any evidence derived from unpublished official record. So the published official record, like NCRB report, like the act passed by the parliament, the preceding minutes, that is published of the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, or a particular committee, the various committee we have in the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, or other state organ where there is the published report. But what is the unpublished record that is just on the deliberation? For that, no one shall be permitted to give the evidence of that. That means if that person want to give the evidence, if any official of the state want to give the evidence of any unpublished record relating to affairs of the state, so that is not permitted. But again, there is an exception, or you can say there is the condition on it, that if the head of the state accept with the permission of the officer at the head of the department concerned, who shall give or withhold such permission as he think fit. Not the head of the state, head of the department, sorry, misled. So if the head of the department concern to which the officials want to disclose any unpublished record, if he permits, then that can be allowed. So Section 123 basically protect the state interest, that as to the functions of the state, as to the affairs of the state, there is unpublished report that is not in the public domain. Something that is in the public domain, there is no issue about it. Because already when the state has published it, that, so how that can cause the injury to the state? How that can cause the damage to the state? But anything that is unpublished, because the way of working, if that is put before the public, if that is allowed, that may cause the larger damage to the public. And that's why that is protected. Section 124 is the official communication. Again, that is somehow related to the state affair. But the difference is that here the Section 124 refer to the communication. And Section 123 refers the affairs, how that it happened or something, if a meeting happened and no minutes has been prepared. So if the minutes has been prepared and that is published, so that is published record, that can, for that the evidence can be permitted. But whatever other than that happened in that particular proceeding, or that is unpublished now, that is not in the public domain, so that is not allowed. Section 124 is protecting only the communication, that no public official shall be compelled to disclose the communication made to him in his official confidence when he considered the public interest would suffer by disclosure. So here there is another difference between Section 123 and 124. Section 123 not permit the official to disclose the unpublished report. That means not permitted. If he voluntarily want to give also, that is not permitted. But in Section 124, he is permitted, but he cannot be compelled. That means if there is an official communication and the person want to disclose that what was that official communication, he is allowed. Okay, so the difference is the section 123 not only permit, okay, but section 124 only protect, only protection against the compulsor. So if the official, if there is a question between A and B, and in that case A have this particular fact that want to disclose that there was an official communication to him by his senior officer, and that's why he did that thing. So he is permitted. Okay. Section 124 does not disclose this communication made to his senior officer to him in his official capacity. But if A does not want to disclose, then the other party by the court cannot compel this person that you have to disclose. Okay, so he cannot compel, but there is the rider that A has to say that if he will disclose, in my opinion, it will be causes the greater public damage. Okay, so when he considered that the public interest would suffer by the disclosure, he would not disclose. Okay, suppose there is a issue between professor in charge and dean faculty of law, and about the official communication between dean of the law faculty to the PIC of our center. And suppose the PIC of our center want to disclose, then C is allowed. Section 124 does not prohibit. But C cannot be compelled when C thinks that it would causes greater public damage, greater public interest. So that is the difference between section 123 and 124. One difference is section 124 covers only the communication. Section 123 covers affairs. It may be the minutes recording. It may be, other effect that is in the unpublished work. The another is that in section, under section 123, the officer not permitted, but under section 124 he has not to compelled. So now there are next section, giving you 1 minute. Yes guys, if you have any doubt about section 123 and 124, you can ask me. Yes, please. Yashmin Malik, आप कभी नहीं बोलती हैं। मिस्टर विश्वजीत,
नो क्वेश्चन सर।
ओके, एनी ऑफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन? आकाश सिंह, डबल ए वाले। सी द नेक्स्ट सेक्शन इज सेक्शन 125 एंड इट्स वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट सेक्शन। See, when I was in this administration of justice, I was assistant district attorney. So at that time, when we used to read the FIR, just give me one minute. I have one. Yes. Yeah, sorry for inconvenience. So when you read, most of the FIR, you will find that the police officer said that we got the information and then we went to the, the place of incident, etc. So the question is that who gave that incident? So section 125 basically protect that thing. See, the police have their own channel. If you have seen the Surfrose movie or some other movie, the police working, उनके खुद के कुछ जो है वो एक इंफॉर्मर होते हैं, और जो एग्जीक्यूटिव मैजिस्ट्रेट होते हैं लॉ इन्फोर्समेंट में, नॉट जुडिशियल मैजिस्ट्रेट, उनके भी इंफॉर्मर होते हैं. एंड सेक्शन 125 बेसिकली प्रोटेक्ट दैट सच पर्सन, पुलिस ऑफिसर एंड मैजिस्ट्रेट कैन नॉट बी कंपेल्ड टू डिस्क्लोज द नेम ऑफ द इंफॉर्मर, नेम ऑफ द पर्सन और द सोर्स फ्रॉम वेयर द इंफॉर्मेशन इज गॉट. सो अगेन दिस प्रोविजन is the privileged communication, this provision protect, and the protection is on the public policy. Because if the name of the informer is has been disclosed, that would cause the damage to the whole the law enforcement process. If you talk about, you know, in any area, like if it is disturbed in the Kashmir, etc., so the police or unke sabke informer hote hain. And in the normal course also, so this provision protect that portion. Section 125, information as to the commission of offences. No magistrate or police officer, that means no magistrate, no police officer, shall be compelled to say whence he got any information as to commission of any offence, and no revenue officer shall be compelled to say whence he got any information as to the commission of any offense against the public revenue. So the public officer, the police officer, magistrate, and the revenue officer, they cannot be compelled to disclose that whence they got the any information. And here the explanation explained that revenue officer in this section means an officer employed in or about the business of any branch of the public revenue. Okay, so this is again on the public policy as I have explained. Now I am moving to the next portion. You know, these two sections, section 126 and 127, basically protect the communication that is between the client and the lawyer. Have you, you know, not have you, I think you all have heard that we have to tell the truth to the doctor and the lawyer. Doctor or lawyer ke samne sachchai batani hai. Because without knowing the full truth, a lawyer cannot prepare one of the best defense. This is, I think, you all accept it. And without knowing each and every details, the doctor cannot prescribe you the medicine. And that's why doctor asks you, ab jaate ho ki ji pet mein dikkat hai ya bukhar hai, kal kya khaya tha, usse pehle kya khaya tha, you have to disclose each and everything. And so just to shave the legal profession, the section 126 and 127 is drafted. Because when you go to a lawyer, suppose there is allegation against you about the rape and murder, and you have to tell every truth so that your lawyer can make a best of the defense. And if lawyer is allowed, if lawyer is permitted to give or disclose the information, so that would be detrimental to you. And that would be, you know, even damaging the whole legal system. Suppose you said, suppose like the situation that you went to the place of the girl, and then both of you had the sexual intercourse and you know, or any other things, and then you found that the girl was murdered or there was something else. If that much of the person you are allowed, so that may go against you also. And that's why, to protect the interest of the client and lawyer, so that otherwise, you know, no client will disclose all the true facts to his lawyer. And that, in that way, in that situation, you know, the lawyer cannot prepare the best of his draft or best of his defense. And so that's why section 126 is there. But section 126 protect only that much of the communication that a client made to him. if the client did anything wrong, if any wrong, if any, you know, you can say crime he has committed, and if this lawyer has seen it, then he can be. But the communication is protected, like in the husband and wife. The communication is protected. If there is the conduct, if wife saw that it's her husband is killing a person, her husband raping her daughter, like the also asked that question. In that case, she is competent witness, he can say. Only the communication is protected. And here is also the whole gist on section 126 and 127 is on the protection of the communication. And that within their legal relationship, professional relationship. No barrister, attorney, pleader, vakil, that means all name that do the legal profession, legal job. So no barrister, attorney, pleader or vakil shall at any time be permitted. Shall at any time be permitted whether they are now your lawyer, now your pleader or not. Like in the section 122, like still your marriage in the subsistence or not. So shall be at any time, shall be at any time means maybe after their professional relation are snapped, after that also they are not permitted with his client, unless with the client express consent. So again, like in the husband consent, they can be permitted. So second part, like here, the client permission, the lawyer or pleader can be permitted to disclose any communication made to him in court and for the purpose of his employment as such barrister, vakil, pleader, or on behalf of his client, or to state content or condition of any document with which he has become acquainted in course and for the purpose of his professional employment, or to disclose any advice given by him to his client in the course and for the purpose of such employment. So like in the section 122, the communication has to be made during the subsistence of the marriage. Here, the communication has to be made to your lawyer and pleader in relation to the employment. As in the personal capacity, if you disclose, that can be given. Suppose your chacha, your you know, uncle is lawyer, and you disclose whatever you have committed to your uncle, but not in the capacity as in his employment, but as his personal capacity as your relative, in that situation, Section 126 would not protect. Unless he say that I wanted my uncle to be my lawyer, and so in that process I said, okay. So in the his employment, if any communication is made, if any advice is given by lawyer or attorney to the vakil, or if as to any documents he is aware, okay. Because when we give the document, when we hire a attorney or a vakil or an advocate, we, you know, say we communicate many things. We show many confidential documents, and you know, the even the advice is given. So all these things are protected. Okay. For the then there are something that is not protected. Before that, the explanation again explain that shall at any time be permitted means even after their relationship is snapped. Now the lawyer and client relationship has not been there, then also it cover. So explanation to the section 126, the obligation stated in this section even after the employment has ceased. Okay, now come to the you know, this proviso, that means the exceptions. Now, if you see and you observe minutely, then you will feel that these proviso is actually not the exception, because the main provision does not cover it. The main provision cover the communication. Suppose A is the client, B is the lawyer. A has said that, sir, maine ek ladki thi, uske saath mera affair tha, and she was less than 18 years, and we had sexual intercourse. So definitely it was statutory rape, because even with the consent, if one has sexual intercourse with a girl less than 18 years, so it is rape. Okay. Then, or maybe suppose it is the murder, etc. Then he shows, suppose the, in another case, there is some property issues and A shows some document to B. Suppose some advice is given by B, his advocate, to the client A. All these things is protected. Proviso says that any communication made in furtherance of illegal purpose. And these communication that we are talking about is in his employment. Now A come to the lawyer. Bhai sahab, kaise, so how I do fraud to get the property of my brother? Now this is not something in his the employment. He want, the communication is in furtherance of his illegal purpose. And so this is not covered. So in the proviso, the two things are covered. Any such communication made in furtherance of illegal purpose. Second, any fact observed by the barrister, pleader, attorney in course of his employment as such, showing that any crime or fraud has been committed since the commencement of his employment. The second is also again the fact observed. So it is not talking about the communication. It is not talking about the document that is proved. The fact he has observed that something fraud has been committed after his employment. Aapko jo document diye, aur document mein sign nahi the, phir is janab ne sign bhi kar diye, frauding, jhoothe. So this is not something that he has communicated or something that the document was showing. This is something, the fact that this attorney or lawyer or pleader observed after getting his employment. And the illustration has beautifully explained these things. Illustration first. A client say to B, an attorney. So A client hai, B uska advocate hai. I have committed forgery and I wish you to defend me. So A has clearly stated that I have committed the forgery and you have to defend me. For that also, if some document is also proved, that about that document also, the B, the attorney, will not be permitted to disclose the that communication and that document. The second, then A, as the defense of man, known to be guilty, is not a criminal purpose. This communication is protected from disclosure. A client says to B, an attorney, I wish to obtain possession of the property by use of the forged deed on which I request you to sue. कि मैं फ्रॉड से किसी की प्रॉपर्टी लेना चाहता हूं और चाहता हूं कि आप उसमें केस दाखिल करो. So this is something that is made in furtherance of the illegal purpose. Because getting the property by the forgery is illegal thing. And so this communication being made in furtherance of the criminal purpose is not protected from the disclosure, or you can say it is covered under the proviso 1. Then the C, A being charged with embezzlement. Embezzlement means theft. Jaise office mein apne paise chura liye, record mein 125 chada diya aur 125 ki jagah आपने केवल 25 रुपए का काम किया था. सो ए बीइंग चार्ज विद एम्बेजलमेंट रिटेन बी एन अटॉर्नी टू डिफेंड हिम. सो ए हैज हायर्ड बी. ओके, इन द कोर्स ऑफ प्रोसीडिंग, अब केस चल रहा है, बी ऑब्जर्व, देन एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम बी हिज अटॉर्नी हिज एडवोकेट ऑब्जर्व दैट एन एंट्री हैज बीन मेड इन एज अकाउंट चार्जिंग ए विद सम सेड टू हैव एम्बेजलमेंट embezzled, which entry was not in the book. So some forged entry was made by the A, his client, during, during the suit proceeding. After the first he has provided that document, there was no such entry, but after that he forcedly made that entry. This being a fact observed by B in course of his employment, showing that a fraud has been committed since the commencement of the proceeding, and it is not protected from such disclosure. Okay, so this is the communication, professional communication protected under section 126. Now there is another question. Suppose there is a lawyer chamber, and when you became lawyer, you will also hire some interpreter or some clerk, munshi wagaira rakhoge. Ab janab A aate hain and he said that maine to sahab B ko killed kar diya. Now suppose you are not permitted, but your clerk, agar wo jaake gawahi de, bhai mere samne kaha tha inhone that he has killed or he has used this thing. So whether he is permitted, again the question is that because this person clerk is present there because of the professional relationship of the client and the barrister. So barrister tha, barrister ke yahan ye kaam karta tha, that's why he is present there. Because the private person ko to wo wakil kahin bahar bhi kar sakta hai ki you go outside, I can tell. But not to his clerk at sector. Unhi se draft karwayega, unhi se cheeze karwayega. And so Section 127 is in line with Section 126. That Section 126 apply to the interpreter, etc. The provisions of Section 126 shall apply to the interpreter and clerk servant of the barrister, pleader, attorney and wakil. So, jo uska sweeper hai, usne suna, that is not allowed. He is not permitted. His clerk not permitted. His interpreter not permitted. हो सकता है कई बार तो क्लर्क ने कहा हो कि वकील साहब आपने देखा ये एंट्री पहले नहीं थी और इस बार इसने बाद में ये फोर्स बनाई है जिसपे मेन केस टिका हुआ है. सो फॉर दैट दैट कैन बी परमिटेड. बट सपोज ए प्राइवेट पर्सन वाज सिटिंग इन द चैम्बर ऑफ द एडवोकेट एंड ही आल्सो हर्ड, नो प्रोटेक्शन बिकॉज यू आर नॉट फोर्स्ड टू मेड दैट कम्युनिकेशन. ओके, कह सकते हो भाई मुझे तो अकेले में बात करनी, सो दैट इज नॉट प्रोटेक्टेड. देन सेक्शन 128 प्रिविलेज नॉट वेव्ड बाय वॉलंटरली एविडेंसिंग. सो दिस टू लिटिल सेक्शन वी डिस्कस सेक्शन 128 एंड 119. इफ एनी पार्टी टू द सूट गिव्स एविडेंस देयर इन एट हिज ओन इंस्टेंस और अदरवाइज ही शैल नॉट बी डीम्ड टू हैव कंसेंटेड देयरबाय टू सच डिस्क्लोजर एज हिज मेंस. So if any party to suit gives the evidence therein at his own instance or otherwise. Suppose this attorney A, client A called as a witness to his barrister. And then in the cross-examination or re-examination, suppose there is a question comes about their communication. So in that case, whether section 126 is deemed to be, you know, waived, yab section 126 nahi lagega, that section 128 covers. That if any party to any suit gives evidence therein at his own instance or otherwise, he shall not be deemed. It shall not be deemed. Law will not presume that he has waived that protection. He shall not be deemed to be consented thereby to such disclosure as is mentioned in section 126, and in any party to the suit or proceeding calls any such barrister, pleader, attorney, wakil or as a witness, unless he shall be deemed to have consented to such disclosure only if the question to such barrister, wakil or matter on matter which but for such question he would be not at this liberty to disclose. Just give me 1 minute. Someone is at my door. Yes. Sorry for the intervention. So this is section 128 that as such, you know, when the party, if he voluntarily comes, then it shall not be deemed that he has, you know, waived the protection that is provided under section 126. Section 129, confidential communication with legal advisor. And now, you know, this talk about the confidential communication, but it is not the pleader or attorney that file the case and the wakalatnama is, you know, put before the court. That is just the legal advice you take to some persons. There are many, you know, firm authorities that, you know, administer, or you can say provided the legal advice. In that situation, no one shall be compelled to disclose to the court any confidential communication which has taken place between him and his legal professional advisor, unless he offer himself as a witness, in which case he may be compelled to disclose any such communication as may appear to the court necessary to be known in order to explain any evidence which he has given but no others. So again, this is something or some provision related to the legal profession, but here the relationship is not that of the attorney, wakil, etc. You as an you put like in the law, in the banks, they have many legal officers. So these legal officer does not put their wakalatnama. They did not file the cases. They do not file the case, etc. But they administer legal advice. In the modern time also, you know, before going to the court, the person get the you know, the legal advice to any matter to which you know they encounter. And so in that case, if that legal advice is tendered by the professional person, that professional person is not compelled. But suppose in that case, like in section 128, if this person has made his legal advisor as a witness, and in that case, you know, the evidence, whatever he is giving, his legal advisor is giving, is not complete unless he has to disclose in that situation. So in that situation, he can be compelled to disclose any such communication as may appear to the court necessary to know in order to explain the evidence which he is given, and not other. So other than that, if a person himself call his legal advisor as an witness, and in that case, there is a question as to the, you know, related to their testimony. In that case, the court, if consider that such communication is necessary to be known in order to explain the evidence, in that case, he can be, you know, forced, he can be compelled to give the evidence, or can compelled to disclose that information, that communication that is made by his client in his professional relationship. So guys, all the sections we have discussed, that deliberation we made on these sections. If you have any question, any confusion related to these sections, you can you know, tell me. Then I will proceed to that. These two cases, very interesting cases, you will find, you know, very interest in reading these cases. We will discuss. Yes, please. Mr. Ajay Kumar. Arshad, any question, any query? Yes. So come to the case. The first case I'm taking, that is in your case material, and many time question is asked from this particular case. M.C. Voges versus T.J. Ponen, 1969, 1 SCC 37. M.C. Voges versus T.J. Ponen, 1969, 1 SCC 37. So here Mr. M.C. Voges was father-in-law and T.J. Ponen was his son-in-law. Uske damad hote. And the problem was that the relationship of T.J. Ponen and Rathi, that was the daughter of M.C. Voges, was not good at that time. And Mr. T.J. Ponen wrote many letters to the Rathi, the daughter of M.C. Voges. And in those letters, the defamatory materials, he written against the father of Rathi, that means Mr. M.C. Voges. Okay. So in the simple words, you can say ki दामाद ने बेटी को लेटर लिखता था और अपने ससुर के बारे में डिफेमेटरी मटेरियल उसमें डिस्क्लोज करता था. नाउ व्हाट हैपेंड दैट द फैक्ट्स ऑफ द केस, एज आई टोल्ड यू दैट दीज आर वेरी सिंपल, सम देयर आर सम अदर फैक्ट्स आल्सो दैट एल्स इज नॉट इंपॉर्टेंट बट वी हैव टू डिस्क्लोज दैट जुलाई 18, 1964, July 25, 1964, and July 30, 1964. So in 1964, on 18 July, 25 July, and 30 July, the Ponen, this T.J. Ponen, wrote from Bombay letter to the Rathi, who was then residing with her parents at Trivandrum, and these three letters were in the questions, that these three letters containing the defamatory information. Then on this case, what Mr. M.C. Voges, the father-in-law of T.J. Ponen, did? He filed a complaint. Okay. He filed a complaint against his son-in-law of the defaming him. On the defense, the T.J. Ponen said that these letters cannot be admissible in the evidence because of the section 122, because this is an official communication during the marriage, and this cannot be permitted to be on the evidence. And if these letters were removed, there is no evidence where the Mr. M.C. Voges can prove that there was a defamation. The argument from the T.J. Ponen side was that I made communication to my wife and not to other than my wife. There is no publication. Because in the case of defamation, section 499 of Indian Penal Code and the punishment in 500, the publication has to be there. And in the law, husband and wife is treated as one person, and so there is no publication. If you say many defamatory things to the person to whom you want to defame. आपको लिफ्ट में मिस्टर एक्स मिल गए और वहीं पे आपने उनको बहुत सारी चीजें की, दैट आप ये लगते हो वो लगते हो. He cannot file defamation case. File तो कर ही देगा, but he cannot win because there is no defamation. For the defamation, if you see the gist of the defamation, that the reputation of the person is lower down in the eyes of right-thinking person. And for that, publication is necessary. When in the lift, there is the person who alleged to defame and there is the person who was defamed. So publication to hua hi nahi. Kisne suna, kiski eyes mein uska reputation kam hua. Filthy language is not a defamation. Aapne kisi ko gaali di, this is not a defamation. Bad word, scolding, filthy language, this is also not defamation. Okay, are you getting my point? So here the two points as made in the defense by the T.J. Poonen. First is that there was no publication because in the law husband and wife is the one person. So मैं अपने आप को कह रहा हूँ कि M.C. Varghese is a very bad person. It is not defamation. The second thing is that the communication that you want to put, that is not permitted because of virtue of section 122. And so whole moot issue is on section 122. What happened that the district magistrate held that the communication by husband to his wife or by wife to the husband is a matter of defamatory of another, does not amount in law to the publication. And since the husband and wife are in the eyes of law in one, and then, you know, he discharged T.J. Poonen. अब वर्गीस साहब ससुर साहब भी सिंपल नहीं लिए उस चीज को. मिस्टर एम.सी. वर्गीस फाइल्ड फॉर रिवीजन इन द कोर्ट ऑफ सेशन. अगेन कोर्ट ऑफ सेशन में होगा रिवीजन. सी देर आर थ्री थिंग्स, बच्चे कंफ्यूज होते हैं, रिव्यू, रिवीजन और रेफरेंस. रिवीजन इज डन बाय द सेम कोर्ट. रिवीजन इज डन, तीन रैप है, तीनों है, रिविजन, रिव्यू, रेफरेंस. रिविजन, रिव्यू, रेफरेंस. रिविजन सेम कोर्ट. रिविजन तो आप ही करोगे ना. रिव्यू हाई कोर्ट, रेफरेंस हाई कोर्ट. रिव्यू हाई कोर्ट, रेफरेंस हाई कोर्ट. यू राइट दीज थिंग्स, कंफ्यूजन हो जाता है. सो रिविजन बाय द सेम कोर्ट एंड देन द ऑर्डर वॉज सेट असाइड एंड द फर्दर इंक्वायरी इन टू द कंप्लेंट. देन ऑन दिस the case was carried by the High Court of the Kerala on that revision. And then the Kerala High Court, you know, set aside the order of the court of the session. That means again the position of the session court before the revision. And then on that, the appeal was preferred because M.C. Varghese ko to feel hua. Then the appeal was preferred to the M.C. Varghese by M.C. Varghese to the Supreme Court. And so this case is from Supreme Court. Now, if you see the both the issue, the facts, we have told that it is about the three letter written by Mr. T.J. Poonen to his wife Rati, who was the daughter of M.C. Varghese, on the 18th July 1964, 25 July 1964 and 30 July 1964 from the Bombay. And there was the alleged defamatory material against the M.C. Varghese. M.C. Varghese filed the case. The issue was whether the defamation was made or not. Okay. On that issue, the final issue that came before the court, the Supreme Court, that whether these letter can be allowed, can be permitted under Section 122 or not, because the session court said that that cannot be permitted and that is between them. So that said that it is permitted, but this is just not the publication. Okay. Now the arguments, the case history also we have discussed, the argument from the T.J. Poonen side, that the two argument, one, it is not a publication, second, if it is a publication, this cannot be permitted. Pehla to ye publication hai hi nahi bhai sahab, hum dono to ek hai. Adi aur Manav dono ek hote hai isse. Second, agar hum dono alag alag bhi hain to bhi ye communication permitted hai nahi, section 122. Now on this, the discussion happened. So on this case, that is available on page number 136 of your case material, the first para about the fact, the second para about how the session court said, decided, then the third para how the session court decided in revision, set aside. Then the fourth para is about the high court. So these two, three, four paras are about the case history. Then issue, I think we have already find it. Then on the arguments and the section para number 14 and para number 16 are about the argument and the decision. Para number 14 says, I'm reading all these paras, very important. A prima facie case was set up in the complaint by Varghese that the complainant has been tried, and we do not see how, without recording any evidence, the learned district magistrate could pass an order discharging the Poonen. Section 122 of the Evidence Act only prevent disclosure in evidence in court of the communication made by husband to the wife. Now, if you see Section 122 basically protect the communication. Communication made between husband and wife, the other party to whom the communication is made, she is not permitted to disclose. So in this case, whatever said by the husband to his wife, Miss Rathi, Rathi was not permitted as per the Section 22. Okay? If you read Section 122, again and again you read it, that in the married life, husband and wife, suppose one spouse made a communication to the another spouse, then the another spouse is not permitted. It's not saying that letter has not been. Don't confuse with the communication with the letter or other material. So the other party, the bar is on the person. And the bar is on the person and only up to the communication that is made. Section 120 clarify that bar is on the person is only up to the communication. To the other thing, if the wife observes, she is not barred. Section 120 allow. If to the other communication, TJ MC Varghese versus TJ Poonam clarify that no, the party is not permitted. If the letter is got, then yes, that can be permitted. Section 122 not cover that. Okay, did you get that point? So, if Rathi appears in the witness box to giving evidence about the communication made to her husband, prima facie the communication may not be permitted to be deposed or to disclose unless the Poonam consent. That Section 122 says. That does not, however, mean that no other evidence which is not barred by Section 122 of Evidence Act or other provision of the Act can be given. Then there is one authority in para number 14. You can read it. Now to the para number 15. The question whether the complaint in this case is an agent of wife because he has received the letter from the wife, that means Mr. M.C. Varghese, and may be permitted to give evidence in a matter on which no opinion at this stage can be expressed. The complainant claims that he has been defamed by writing of letters. The letters are in possession and are available for being tendered in evidence. We see no reason why inquiry into the complaint should, on the preliminary contentions raised, be prohibited. If the complainant seek to support his case only upon the evidence of the wife of the accused, he may met with the bar with the Section 122 of the Evidence Act. Whether he will be able to prove the letter in other manner is a matter which may left to be determined at the trial, cannot be made subject matter of the inquiry at this stage. 117, para number 17. One more question which may be raised by the counsel was briefly referred to. It was ours that since the matter reached this court, Rathi has obtained decree for the nullity of the marriage. And so now she can be permitted. No. Section 122 says that even after the marriage, she cannot be allowed to, or she cannot be permitted to give the disclose the communication. And we, because of para number 14 and para number 16, the decision is at the para number 19. We are therefore in the view that appeal must be allowed and the order passed by the High Court set aside. And that means that can be read as in the evidence. There is no bar by the Section 122. But whether the defamation was or was not there, that has to be again decided by the trial court, that district magistrate. So the proceeding will be remanded back for the trial to the magistrate according to the law. So the moot question whether these letters can be allowed to read in the evidence is decided by the Supreme Court that the scope of the Section 122 is limited one. The bar by the Section 122 is on the person, is on the spouse. And that bar is also limited up to the communication made during the marriage. So, if there is a letter, etc., other thing, they can be produced, but the spouse cannot be compelled to give the evidence. If the spouse want to give the evidence of other things she observed, she saw, she hear, she can give. As per the Section 120, she is a competent witness against his wife or against her husband. So the MC Varghese versus TJ Poonen has, you know, very wonderfully explained the scope of Section 122. So with this, this section is over. Now the another case I will take, and that is again very important. But before that, 1 minute I am giving you to ask any question that you have in your mind with respect to this case, MC Varghese versus TJ Poonen. Yeah, Asad has asked. Yes, please write your questions. It will be very pleasure for me to answer the question. Can she hand over those letters to the father? Yes, she can. Yes, she can. There is no bar on handovering the letter, etc. Okay. Now the second case, and this is on the Section 123, the affairs of the state. And this is really very, the historic case in the Indian legal history. See, the Indira Gandhi government, and that was the very powerful government when she was in the power. But one person, Mr. Raj Narayan. Mr. Raj Narayan, wo uske piche pad gaya haath dhoke. And Mr. Raj Narayan fought election against Ms. Gandhi in Rai Bareilly constituency. And she won the election also. She sweep the majority and she formed the government. But Mr. Raj Narayan, he was from Banaras family, Rajgharana. He was, that Bhumihar Brahmin. So very stement and, he is remembered for his, this stamina of fighting against the powerful government in that way. So he filed the case. He filed the case that there was the malpractices, there was the bribery by the then Prime Minister, the Honorable Prime Minister. And, she used the police machinery when she used to do the election rally, government machinery. So there was the malpractices. And so this was the very historic in the Indian history. And the case was heard. And, Justice Jagmohan Sinha, he was the judge of the High Court. And he instructed that when Mr. Gandhi will came into the court, no one will stand. And at that time, Mr. Gandhi was the Prime Minister. No one will stand to give the respect. This is not to disrespect the Prime Minister, but this is with the aim that she is just a, here just a, the accused in that sense. And there was later on, there were some reports also that Jagmohan was even offered to get promoted to the Supreme Court, but he did not want that. And that shows the integrity of the judiciary. And she finally convicted Ms. Gandhi that as such, there was no bribery, because that has to be proved by some more evidences. But yes, there was malpractices by the Representation of the People's Act, and election was nullified. Even she was barred to sit in the office for the 6 years. And this is the case that changed the political, atmosphere in the country. Okay, sometimes people say that this thing is happened very unprecedented without knowing the history. See the powerful, how powerful government was of the Indira Gandhi. She was nationalizing, and whole the corporate world was against her. Many persons, against was, and the Congress was in the power with 30 years. Unprecedented 30 years if one party is in the power. So many factors were there. Malpractices was also there, as per the judgment. I'm not saying with my personal experience. And then what happened? That this case, Mr. Rajmohan was his lawyer was Shanti Bhushan, the father of Prashant Bhushan, and Indira Gandhi was defended by none other than the Nani Palkiwala. Later on, she appealed to the Supreme Court, and in the Supreme Court, the five judges bench, Justice A.N. Ray, this judgment is from the Chief Justice A.N. Ray. Chief Justice A.N. Ray also, observed that yes, there was malpractices, but remove that part, that the bar on the Indira Gandhi for the 6 years for sitting in the office. And after, this judgment on the 25th June 1975, the Prime Minister approached to the Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed, and the emergency was imposed. In the Indian history, this type of emergency was unprecedented. Because of the political turmoil, then the article, that emergency provision was amended. And the armed rebellion was, the word was put in the emergency provision. And so this provision is, this case is really very, very important. Now the question that we have in this case was that Mr. Raj Narayan, he argued that the summon has to be given by Allahabad High Court to three persons. And along with that document, then the defense taken by the opposite party is that those documents were the unpublished official record. And so Section 123 of the Evidence Act protect that privileged communication, and then they are not forced, they are not compelled by Mr. This Raj Narayan to produce those documents. So that is the whole question in this particular case, the history that is related to this thing I have told you. Then, emergency, after that, again, the Raj Narayan, fought, and then he defeated the Indira Gandhi in the 1977 election. This case is from 1971 Lok Sabha election, okay? Para number... first is about this particular thing. Para number two is about this particular election petition before the High Court of Allahabad on the application on 27th July 1973 for summoning certain witnesses. Then there are three witnesses on para number 3, 4, and 5. First is the Secretary General Administrator, State of Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow, or any officer authorized by him. On summon to produce inter alia circulars received from the Home Ministry and the Defense Ministry of Union Government regarding the security and the tour arrangement of the Srimati Indira Gandhi, the respondent in election petition for tour program of Rai Bareilly district on February 24-25-1971, or any general order for the security arrangement, and all correspondence between the state government and the government of India, and between the chief minister and the prime minister regarding police arrangement of the meeting. So regarding the communication by the Home Ministry and Defense Ministry of the Union Government regarding their arrangement, The second, the Chief Secretary Government of Uttar Pradesh was also someone in trial of the document that related in section, this para number 4. And the 5 is head clerk of the SP about to the document relating to tour program of the Srimati Indira Gandhi of the district Rai Bareilly, all the document relating to the arrangement of police security measures adopted by police, and all document relating to the expenses. Because the main argument was that that through the state expenses, she won the elections. Okay. So the expenses incurred on the police personnel, arrangement of the police arrangement for the construction of rostrum, fixation of loudspeaker and other arrangement through superintendent of police district Rai Bareilly. So that is the thing. Now, on this summon on September 3, 1973, though this case is very long, you have to read it so that in the detail so that you understand it. On the para number 6, on September 3, 1973, summon was issued to the general administrator. The summon was endorsed by confidential department of department, general department on September 3, as will appear on the paragraph 5 by the affidavit of R.K. Cole, the commissioner and the secretary in charge. On September 5, there was an application by Chief Standing Council, Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow, on the clarification to the effect that the chief secretary is not personally required to be pursuant to the summon. The learned judge made an order on that date that chief secretary need not to personally attend. On the confidential issue, the High Court with the document summoned and to claim privilege, this will appear to the application of Saxena dated September 19, 1973. On the para number 8, then Saxena was examined by the High Court on September 10, 1973, and on September 10, there was an application on behalf of the election petitioner that the claim of privilege by the Saxena in his evidence to be rejected. And so the whole controversy is about this privileged communication. Then on para number 12, para number 14, para number 17, you will find this discussion about the preliminary questions that whether this is a, privileged communication or not. There is one blue book, and this blue book is regarding the arrangement done by the officers. And this was an unpublished official record. So this is one of the documents. Then on the para number 14, that the learned judge expressed the following view. Under section 123 of the Evidence Act, the minister or head of department concerned must file an affidavit at first instance. No such affidavit was filed at the instance. The court cannot exercise duty under section 123 of Evidence Act suo motu. The court can function only after privilege has been claimed by the affidavit. It is only when the permission has been withheld under section 123 of Evidence Act the court will decide. Saxena in his evidence did not claim the privilege after the law department notice in the file that privilege should be claimed. The Saxena was allowed to brief the blue book without being sealed in the cover. The head of department should have sent tile blue book and sealed along with them. So the High Court has observed that it is after the petitioner said that there has not been this argument of the privileged communication. For claiming the privileged communication, the document has to be, bring in the court in a sealed cover. Okay. And that is with the affidavit that this is a privileged communication. But that has not been done. And so High Court said that, with that protection, we cannot give. This is the observation of High Court. The judgment is from the Supreme Court. Then the Supreme Court, there are some more pages where the two important case, one is the Sukhdev case, state of Punjab versus Sodhi Sukhdev. On the para number 17, that the court has power to inspect the document regarding which privilege is claimed, but because the blue book is not an unpublished official record, there is no necessity to inspect the Blue Book. Blue Book is not an unofficial, unpublished official record. And then on para number 39, you know, this 39, 40 and 41, you will find much discussion on the section 123. The first question which fall for the decision is whether the learned judge was right that he said that the privileged communication, for privileged communication, the affidavit has to be filed, etc. The Supreme Court is observing on this issue in the para number 39. The first question which fall for decision is whether the learned judge was right in holding the privilege was not claimed by filing an affidavit at the first instance. The counsel on behalf of election petitioner submitted that in case in which evidence is sought to be held in respect of matter derived from unpublished record relating to the affair of the state at a stage of the proceeding when the head of the department has not come into the picture, has not had an opportunity of exercising discretion under section 123 to claim privilege, it will be the duty of the court to give effect to the section 123 and prevent the evidence being leaked till the head of the department had an opportunity to claim the privilege. But in case in which document are summoned, it is said that counsel for election petitioner, the opportunity of claiming the privilege in a legal manner has already been furnished when summon is received by head of the department. If he does not claim privilege, the court is under no legal duty ask him to give another opportunity. So the Supreme Court also said that yes, as such court has to even you know, exercise the discretion under section 123, but the head of the department has not, you know, claim the privilege. In that case, the court has no duty to ask him or to give him the another opportunity. So the they has rejected, and on that, you know, this privileged communication, one point is clear that for that affidavit has to be given, the document has to be bring in the court in the sealed cover. Okay. Then on the para number 14, the document in respect of which exclusion for production is claimed are Blue Book. As per that Blue Book are not the unpublished book. Being rule and instruction from the protection of Prime Minister when on tour and in travel, Saxena come to the court and gave the evidence that Blue Book was a document relating to the affair of the state and not to be disclosed. The secretary filed an affidavit on September 20, 1973 and claimed privilege in respect of Blue Book by submitting that the document relating to the affair of the state should be excluded from the production. The several decisions in which reference has made established that the foundation of the law behind the Section 123 and Section 162 of the Evidence Act is the same as in the English law. It is that injury to the public interest is the reason for the exclusion, that the basic principle behind the Section 123 is injury to the public. The public interest which demand that the evidence be withheld to be weighed against the public interest in administration of justice, that the court should have the fullest possible access to all relevant material. When public interest outweigh the latter, the evidence cannot be admitted. The court will proprio motu exclude the evidence, the production of which contrary to the public interest. So that the section 123 is founded on the English principle that if the public interest is to be injured, ye wait karna padega ki ab uski value zyada hai ki public interest zyada injured kara. If public interest is injured is higher in the weight, then it has not to be disclosed, otherwise it can be disclosed. Simple thing. So the reason is that such document became subject to the privilege by reason of this content. Confidentiality is not a head of privilege. It is consideration to bear in the mind. It is not that the content contain material which is would be damaging to the national interest to divulge, but rather than that the document would be the class which demand protection. To illustrate, the class of the document would embrace cabinet paper, foreign office dispatch paper regarding the scrutiny of the state of the high level, inter-departmental minutes, in ultimate analysis, the content of document are so described that it could not be seen at once that in public interest, document are to be withheld. Then the para number 42, that it is now well settled practice in our country that an objection is raised by an affidavit affirming by the head of department, the court may also require the minister to affirm an affidavit that will raise the course of the inquiry by the court as to whether the document should be withheld from the disclosure or not. If the court is satisfied with the affidavit evidence, the document should be protected in public interest from the production in the matters ends there. If the court yet to satisfy itself may see the document. Okay. And the on this law, the court said that no affidavit is there, nothing is there. So how that has to be weighed? Then the next question, it is on para number 45, whether the learned judge was right in holding that the blue book is not an unpublished. That means blue book to a published document hai. And section 122 केवल अनपब्लिश्ड डॉक्यूमेंट को प्रिविलेज्ड करता है. ऑन द बिहाफ ऑफ द इलेक्शन पिटिशनर इट इज सेड दैट द पार्ट ऑफ द डॉक्यूमेंट वाज पब्लिश्ड बाय द गवर्नमेंट पैरा नंबर 71 क्लॉज 6 इन द रिट प्रोसीडिंग व्हेन द ब्लू बुक दैट इज इन द क्वेश्चन दैट इट इज अनपब्लिश्ड एंड दैट हैज टू बी प्रोटेक्टेड बाय सेक्शन 123 ऑफ द एविडेंस एक्ट दैट ऑलरेडी बीन पब्लिश्ड इन द पैरा नंबर 71(6). In the writ proceeding, it is also said that the respondent to the election petitioner to the blue book in the answer filed in the court and the case Camel Laird, it was said that though some of the paper has been produced before the tribunal of inquiry and therefore reference was made to those paper in the inquiry, yet the privilege can be claimed. Two reasons were given. One is the special precaution and the another is that the portion of the tribunal setting may be secret. In present case, it cannot be said that blue books is a published document, so that the court held that yes, blue book is an unpublished work and the protection can be claimed. Any document of the part of the blue book which may be described as innocence part of the document will not render the entire document as a public. So maybe the some portion of the document is published as claimed by the Rajnarayan that it is on the para number 71(6). In the writ petition, it was published, some portion. That does not mean that whole blue book became the published work. And so the court after the authority said that maybe the some portion was set. And so in that line, the blue book was held to be, unpublished work. And then finally the decision on the para number 46, that for these reasons the judgment of the High Court is set aside. The learned judge will consider the affidavit affirmed by the RK Cole and the learned judge will give an opportunity to the head of the government to file the affidavit in respect of document summoned to be produced by the superintendent of police. The learned judge will consider the affidavit. If the learned judge will be satisfied on the affidavit that document required protection from the production, the matter will disclose. So on this thing that whether he can be give the affidavit or it is unpublished work, for that the Supreme Court has allowed. But the Supreme Court has not said that it cannot be produced before the court and court cannot read. Only the things that it is the privileged or the confidential communication, then the High Court again has to decide that whether they can see it in the public interest or not, because the para number 46 is clear that the whole law is based on the English law, that the public interest has to seen at one side and the administration of justice in that particular case is on the another side. So only in this case the matter is again back to the High Court, that High Court has to decide after filing the affidavit that there was a that they claim that the privileged communication. High Court has to decide that yes, this privileged communication they want to read in the public interest or they did not want to read. If they said that yes, greater public injury would cause, maybe that is not allowed. If they said no, the greater public injury will not cause, and in the interest of justice, it is required, so they may read it. So only on this point, on the section 123, the position is clarified. I have taken 10-12 minutes of your time. So with this, today class is over. And this R. Madanappa judgment, you know, you please read it. If I will find time, I will discuss in some other class. So the next class will be on the Wednesday. And in the Wednesday, we will discuss the witnesses. You know, the as such, if you see in the case material, the chapter is basically about accomplice, section 133 and 114B. But see, because we are reading 122, so 118, 119, 120, 121, these are just near to this section. So on the witnesses, we will discuss who can be the competent witness, child witness, dumb witness, etc. And one case that is provided in your case material. And, you know, if I will find this R. Madanappa case also, we discuss. And then in the, you know, the Saturday class, we will discuss this accomplice. And on the Monday class, we will complete the whole syllabus. So with this, today class is over. If you have any question, any query with the, you know, these sections with the today's discussion,